Yes, Dave Vayeside, you are welcome once again. Dave Vayeside, we started our discussion on validity and reliability. So further the discussion today. Today I want us to look closely on specifically on reliability, how we can actually do some calculation, you know, just to go beyond the theoretical aspect. How do you come face to face with real data and determine reliability? I think we can discuss that today. But for the benefit of those who are joining for the first time also, those who were not around on Tuesday, I just graphically just rush through the basic concept again. Then why I will now dwell more on reliability. We know that once an instrument has been developed, the reliability and the validity of the instrument need to be evaluated. When we talk about instrument, we talk about it can be a questionnaire. Most of the time it's a questionnaire. But sometimes it may not be questionnaire, it may be a particular, even physical instrument for making diagnosis or for making some assessment or a method, maybe a method like assessing finger clubbing. You know, in this case, you are making an assessment. The dentists, they do a lot of assessment. The rates, you know, they give scoring. So it may not be instrument. Some of them, it may not be questionnaire. There's sometimes maybe a combination of questionnaire, or you ask some question, you carry out some examination. So whichever way, any method used to, you know, assess something, you need to do the reliability and also validity. Reliability and validity are the two ways that researchers evaluate the quality of an instrument or the quality of a method. What validity means, just means that this method, this instrument, assesses or probing what it purports to probe. Degree to which it measures what it's supposed to measure. You can be using an instrument, it may be measuring something else, may not actually measure. For example, say you are measuring quality of life. The instrument may not actually measure quality of life. Of course, when you apply it, it will give you value, but the value may not actually measure the quality. How are we sure? And before you know, you begin to use the instrument or that method, how do you know it's measuring what it's supposed to measure? That is the validity. Now, reliability means consistency. This method, this instrument, if I use it now, I use it again, does it give the same result? If you use it on different occasions in the same similar setting, will it give the same result? If I use it, another person is using it concurrently somewhere, are we doing the same thing? Is it giving us the same result? That is the consistency of that method or that instrument. That is the reliability. Now, we are related. Now, it is possible an instrument is not both reliable or valid. You know, this is a pictorial view just to show. This first one is showing, you know, if you throw in a dart and arrow, you are playing a dart. If you are aiming at the center, let's assume the center, when it is the center, it is valid. That is the aim. If you are throwing a dart, you aim at the center. Now, if you now begin to hit the periphery, that is not valid. It's meant to create a mental picture. So when it's hitting the periphery, it's not actually going to where it's supposed to go. It's not valid. Even apart from the fact that it may not be going to the center, if you cannot hit a spot consistently, it's not consistent, it's not reliable. So reliability is about consistency. So if you look at the second circle or the dart, picture of the dart, you will see that, you know, the arrow was aiming at a particular spot consistently, but it was not aiming at the center. That should have, it is reliable, but not valid. So it's possible an instrument is giving consistently no similar result, but it's not actually measuring what you set out to measure. So a method or instrument or a tool can be reliable, but not valid. So the third option you see there is that it's hitting the center consistently. So there's consistency, that is, it's reliable. It's hitting where it's supposed to hit, that is valid. So an instrument can measure what it's supposed to measure, what you plan to measure, and if you use it consistently, it gives you consistent result. So it is both valid and reliable. Now, it is possible, you can see that it is possible here that an instrument is reliable but not valid. But another option that may come to mind, can instrument or a tool be valid and is not reliable? So many people know is when you are trying to think of alternative, is a possible alternative you can think of. But in the real life, if validity is what we say it is, for a tool to measure what it's supposed to measure. So if, for example, if you throw a dart and it hit the center once, and other is not hitting the center, it's not consistently hitting it. But as it hits the center, you say, oh, it's valid. You cannot say it's valid. Because it becomes a gambling. Because sometimes it may measure what it's supposed to measure, sometimes it may not measure because it's not consistent. So validity, for a instrument to be valid, it has to be consistent. So reliability is a necessary condition, but not sufficient condition for validity. So for an instrument to be valid, it has to be, first of all, reliable. But it can be reliable without being valid. Reliability alone does not mean validity. The reliability must be there. So it's a necessary condition, but not sufficient condition for reliability. So it has to be validity. It has to be reliable. Then with some other thing, it has to be valid. And that is why the right side of the slide, you see example I gave. And I gave a third example apart from this first one that is neither reliable nor valid. This one, reliable nor valid. Then this last one, reliable and valid. But you see this third one here. Fairly valid, but not very reliable. Just to iron out that gray area. So it's not possible for an instrument to be valid without being reliable. If it's not reliable, it cannot be valid. So that is just an area of emphasis. And also talk about other related terms like practicability. That is it practicable when we consider this money, effort, and time? Is it easily, you can easily design it? You can easily administer it? You can easily interpret it, especially in a particular setting? So that is practicability. The backward effect. What effect does it have on teaching and learning? So there are some methods that will facilitate teaching and learning. Some methods, even though it may be valid, may be reliable, but maybe difficult. Well, it's related to practicability also. Maybe difficult for people to understand. Even though it may be cheap, but if it's difficult for people to understand. So the backward effect. Those are related time. So look at, I also gave a picture of the different approaches, which is now called different type of reliability. But they are approaching because them, you can see them as type also, because the different type of approaches are applicable in a different setting. There are no, we don't have one particular setting for research setting or setting of an instrument. The characteristic of instrument will determine the type of reliability you can carry out to ensure that the data stream of data coming from that method is consistent. So you see here, reliability at the center, you see four different types around those yellow. So even those different types can be broken down into classes. What really comes to mind is test reliability. In a situation where you just carry out a test, and that test, most of the time, the one that will require test reliability does not actually depend solely on somebody's rating. Like the questionnaire now, if questionnaire be well designed, it will be easily administered. It's easily admissible, and it's just for the person to follow the protocol and administer the antique. So it does not depend on the rating of that person. It's just for you to administer the questionnaire. Even some may be self-administered. So you don't even need the rating of anybody. So even if it is interview administered, doesn't need the rating of the interviewer. So in that case, what you want to validate directly is related directly to the stream, the instrument, the questionnaire, or the method. In that case, the best way to do reliability of that instrument is to administer the instrument to a set of respondents and now wait for a time that, especially if the respondent, is a form of questionnaire that the respondent has to, when you say respondent, answer. You wait until for a time that they will have forgotten the answer. If you, maybe you have 20 items, you wait for maybe a week or sometime that if you bring the questionnaire back, the person is not likely to remember this is what I tick for this one. There is not, it's short enough for the attribute you are mentioning not to have changed also. For example, if you want to know quality of life, you want to a particular instrument for quality of life. If you administer it, if you wait for a week or 2 weeks, it's not possible for the quality of life of that person to have changed within 2 weeks. But the person also, it's possible for him to have forgotten, if you see the instrument again, to have forgotten what it takes for each of them. So when you administer it again to the same set of people, you now compare the score. So it should correlate. People that score high before should score high now. That shows that they are, maybe they score high in that thing. If people that score moderately should call moderately again. People that score low should score low again. Because that attribute you are measuring has not changed. So if you can get that people that score high score high again. So there's near perfect, not actually perfect. There will be a strong correlation between the two scores before and after for the group of people responded. That is test-retest reliability. Test-retest. Well, if it is something that maybe is not questionnaire, maybe it's a particular, maybe rapid test you want to admit, you give up. Of course, you have to do an interval that within interval that the attribute you are changing within that you are measuring within that change. You now compare the result before and after to the same set of people. That's test reliability. And it's very simple. We're going to see an example. We're going to see, appreciate it. The second one is okay. Maybe I just quickly go to, because there's a slide that contain more information by each of them. The other one that really come to mind is parallel form. You look at the opposite. parallel form. In a situation when you have a particular tool occur more in more than one form, and those two or three or four format are accepted as the same thing. For example, RDT, rapid diagnosis test for malaria. We have two major types that we know we circulate around. We have the one that contain histidine protein and the one that contain lactate dehydrogenase. You see that it is really both of them do the same thing, but they are different. So how reliable, in the sense, what we mean by reliable, if I use histidine, is it consistent with when somebody is using lactate dehydrogenase? Or if we are doing a particular study or we are doing something now, and some are using maybe, some are using histidine, some are, we administer histidine to protein to another one, some people lactate dehydrogenase to another one, are they measuring the same thing? That is it consistent? The result we are getting from different forms, are they consistent? So in that case, if you want to know, it's just for you to administer the same thing to, like for the blood. Now you take the same blood and do the two, use the two, RDT at the same time for all of them and see if the result, if there's no much difference in the result. So now the method you now, okay, we talk about the statistical method we use depends on the variable. And that's why you need understanding of your variable. Once you know, understanding the concept of reliability, validity is one thing. Then understanding the statistical aspect is different. Once you understand some basic statistics like correlation, like when you are dealing with categorical variable, how do you know association between categorical variable? You are talking about maybe chi square or whatever. Though there are different tests that have been, especially when it comes for the categorical one, there are different tests that have been, designed. And for the quantitative, most of the time, it's correlation. But you will discover that for reliability, intelligent people also have come with what they call reliability coefficient that close to it. It's actually a correlation. But they will come, designed in such a way that is a little bit packy, because correlation will have negative, reliability will not have negative value. Correlation can have negative, you can have negative correlation. But for reliability, usually in positive direction. Because we cannot say something is measuring something and it's the same, and now measuring in opposite direction. No, it cannot happen. For reliability, you cannot have negative value. So the parallel form, for example, also, if you want to maybe under validity, that woman will work also. NECO and WAEC, or West African National. If they say, it's the same syllable they are using. If they say it's the same thing, there's a claim that it's the same thing. West African exam and national exam is the same. Or NECO and WAEC is the same. The same syllable is the same thing. So you may want to see, if that's the case, these questions, the examination, are they consistent? No, can you say if somebody sits for NECO is as well sitting for if the person pass had the distinction in NECO, if you're able to have the similar thing in white, if you sit, the person sit for the examination, those are parallel form, doing the same thing, but they are different. Now, we also call it equivalent. Then you have agreement. This agreement, if you look at these two now, test retest, parallel form. The judgment of somebody administering it has not even come in. It's minimal. As per for test retest now, I've already said you can even use self-administer. No, the person, the influence of the person administering the as not actually administering the test is not prominent. Unlike the other one we call intra-rate agreement, scoring agreement. Yeah, that scoring agreement could know that we have two, we're not really two scoring system. It's the same scoring system. But here now, the people doing the scoring, do they agree? Like for example, when we assess finger clubbing, you know, there's a standard, or Glasgow coma scale. But the issue there is that the Glasgow coma scale and finger clubbing is not the problem. The problem now is individual administering it. So sometimes when you look at somebody's finger, you may say that's grade 3. Another person may look and say grade 2. Because the rater now come into play. Because it depends on the judgment of the rater. So there are many tests like that you need to do some examination and look and know when you are palpating. You say you are looking at chest examination. All these things you are doing. It depends. What you when you say somebody has a particular ulcer. Yes, you listen with your stethoscope. But it's you, it's human being that listens. So you can classify the type of ulcer you have. Another person may listen and say it's another thing. So in that situation, there's a way you now try to say, okay, if you want to know how consistent this current system is, as per between rater or within rater, because you yourself, you can come and check somebody's finger and say, oh, this is grade 3. In the afternoon, you come back, you examine it, say it's grade 2. You know, the issue there is that that particular test does see how consistent is the result by given by the rater. So it can be if you want to do within the rater, intra-rater, then between rater, inter-rater. And as a way we look at it, the kappa, current kappa, as described away. The last one is internal consistency. This one now is actually, it's not even dealing with rater or whatever the administrator, but that the inherent property of, because when you talk about instruments, especially tools like a questionnaire, there are many components that make up the questionnaire. This questionnaire, are they speaking the same thing? You're like somebody, you are going for a physics exam. It's physics exam, but they're now bringing biology question, bringing other questions that are not related. So if you, in internal consistency, is looking at, if you are talking of quality of life, or you are talking of depression or anxiety, that's what you want to measure. All those questions, are they all pointed towards anxiety? Are they pointed towards that particular thing? That is internal consistency. If they point towards the particular thing, all of them, or if somebody score high in one, it should score high in the other one. If they are pointed towards, if somebody score low in one, it should score low in the other one. So that shows that the even though they are different questions, but they are saying, they are pointing towards the same thing. So how do you measure that? That is the internal consistency. So reliability, some people now come with they talk about reliability coefficient. Just like the way we have correlation, just to measure, you know, to be able to quantify the reliability degree to which the instrument is consistent with what it gives out. And it's on a scale of 0 to 1. Just like correlation, the only difference is that you have not have negative value. It's actually correlation coefficient, but without negative value. Now, I think I've explained all this on the table. Let's just look at an example. Through the example, you'll be able to get the understanding of all the four different types of measure of reliability. And you don't look at it, I cannot say you cannot do two of them. You can do. The one you can do with others is the internal consistency, because it's measuring something else different from the other. So you can do the internal consistency, then you can do test retest in some situation, and do internal consistency and do parallel form. But as a situation, if it is physical instrument, there is nothing like internal consistency. Now, let's look at one example. This is an example test retest. We have an instrument that measures quality of life. And this instrument we have, the instrument was administered to 30 people. Maybe after 1 week or 2 weeks, the same 30 people, you get their name and their location, you go back to measure, to administer the questionnaire. Now, you will have waited for long a time that the people will have forgotten the answer they gave before, and not too long for the quality of life to have changed. 2 weeks is okay, because if somebody bring a question and begin, or you are asking a question, because there are plenty, just one question, and it's not just yes or no, it's something that on the like scale. So it will take, strongly agree, or all this, not agree, whatever. So after 2 weeks, the person will have forgotten. And the quality of life wouldn't have changed within 2 weeks also to the administer. So these are the score, the two score. All you need to do is to do the correlation. Why I take pain to calculate with hand and run with SPSS is that anybody assessing the material, the module, the slide, be able to see, because this one to me is like repetition, because there's a section we have talked much about correlation. It's correlation you use here, because it's about scoring. And there's score, we have score. So score before and after, for the same people. So you correlate, don't run the correlation, Pearson correlation. And that's why you see the formula for Pearson here. So you just, the first one, you just see is X, the second one is Y. Anyone can be X or Y, doesn't matter. First one can be Y, the second one can be head. So you feed in, you put in all this deviation. This is a square deviation, all the things necessary in the formula. Because I will not be explaining, if I start explaining that, I'm explaining correlation again. And we have talked much about correlation, and the videos are the materials are there. So this correlation, just calculate the Pearson correlation. It's very simple. So if it's test retest and it's about scoring, just correlate. Do calculate the Pearson correlation coefficient. Know that this instrument, it has many questions. Each of the questions was placed on like SK. Let's say it's only one question that is placed on like SK, yes, it may not be appropriate for you to use Pearson. You may have to use PEMA. But it's many questions, and then you now had an aggregate score. By the time you had aggregate score, you will have introduced a form of decimal into it. When you have had aggregate score, so there's level of continuity in it. So that is why it's appropriate. You can use Pearson correlation. And when you do it, this is the answer. And when you run the same thing with SPSS, it gives the same, look at it. The correlation is 0.615, where it's fairly, because it's a moderate correlation. So you can really say that moderately, because sometimes people look at correlation of 0.8 as strong. Anything, 0.8 and above, strong correlation. 0.65 to 0.8 is moderate. So you can say there's a moderate correlation. So you can say the reliability is moderately high. That is test retest. Now, if it is something that is categorical, of course, is the cross tabulation you do. But let's look at the next example. This example talk about the parallel form. In the situation where you have, it's the same logic. In this case now, you are not doing the test and coming back. You are missing the two type of tests to the same person, because it's a different form of the test you are administering to the same person. Now, this is an example. There are two forms of the test, A and B, with a total of 13 items per test. Scoring is based on allowing up to 3 points per item, making 39. the highest possible. Look at that. A group highest possible score 39. A group of normal 5-year-old children was selected and given from A. Then the next day, they were given B. The accompanying table showed the data and scheme of calculation. So this is an example. Scheme of calculating reliability coefficient. This is because it's different form. In test return, it's the same instrument you are administered on two occasions. But this one is two form of, they are similar, but they are different. But you believe that they are doing the same thing. Just like say, why question, NECO question, believed to be biology question, both of them, the same standard. You may want to, okay, let the person sit for this one, not sit for this one. So in that situation, it's, you correlate the result also, the same person correlation. Look at here, the correlation is 0.76. This one is stronger than the other one. Still moderately high correlation. That is parallel form. Now, this one may interest you. Intrarater and interrater. In a situation where the test depends on the rating of the investigator, or the person collecting the data. Like most dentists, only is there any dental research that they will not do kappa. The more the rating something, you know, we have a lot of teeth and they have way of, you know, rating, scoring teeth. Is this one, the cap is this different than the U. So, and they put on the Likert scale. Usually use Likert scale. So, in that, because it's subjective, because whatever score you give depends on the person, experience of the person, the knowledge of the person. So you want to see how consistent that method is to its current kappa. Kappa describes this method. What it does, what it did, was to say when you do the cross tabulation, I think the cross tabulation is here, because I like even from practical point of view. This is an example. In a situation where people rated, that showed that they will have rated on a Likert scale. And it's, even though it's ordinary, it's categorical, maybe 1 to 5 or 1 to 3 or whatever. So if you are doing intrarater, that showed that you rate 2 times. If you rate 2 times, what did you score? You will not cross-tabulate, but you have category, the option, limited number of options. So the outcome, possible outcome are limited. So you now do cross-tabulation to see where they agree, where they do not agree. If it is two people in tarita that rated the same thing, you still cross-tabulate, doesn't really matter. Like example given here now, two dentists rated, they show the distribution of score 2104, two surfaces made separately by two dentists using a scale of 0 to 3. So we have 4 options, 0, 1, 2, 3. So you want to calculate the interrater reliability. So what Curran did is to look at the diagonal, look at the diagonal. So if you look at the diagonal, is the agreement. So if you look at dentist one, dentist two, the second dentist, so this one has 0, 1, 2, 3. These are the rating. This one, 1, 2, 3, or 0, 1, 2, 3. So where this person says 0 and this person says 0, how many of them? So all, then where this first one say 1 and the other one say 1, how many of them? Where the first one say 2, rated 2, and the other one rated 2, how many of them? The same thing with 3. So all those one, the agreement, they are along the diagonal. What we have of the diagonal are the disagreement. So actually, if you remember, for some of us that have been with us for some time, when we discuss this McNamara and McNamara and Baukar chi-square, it's the same logic. It's the same logic. So the interest is on the diagonal, yeah. But in that one, the interest is on the off the diagonal. In McNamara and McNamara Baukar, the interest of the statistician is on the off the diagonal, not the agreement. But here, the interest is on the agreement, because what you are looking at is how do they agree. So, because that one, the McNamara's own, you are testing no hypothesis. That one is testing no hypothesis. And when they agree, it means that there's no difference. So, and that is the no hypothesis. So, what you are not interested in that one because there's no change. But the one that is called the diagonal, that's where they disagree. That is the interest in McNamara and McNamara. But for Kappa, the diagonal, the printer one is the. Is the interest. And what you just like what you do with anything with a categorical variable, you cross tabulate like this. What you see here now is the expected value for the diagonal. You want to know the expected value, the observed value for the diagonal. But you want to know the expected value. The expected value, if you remember, is the row total for each cell, row total times column total divided by the grand total. So for each column, for each diagonal, what is the total for the row? Multiplied by what is the total for the column and divided by the total grand total, which are the corner. So that's what you do for all of them to calculate the expected value. So you see the expected value. And what Corona see is that the kappa is, you divide the addition of the diagonal, look at it. The addition of the diagonal divided by the total observed frequency, OD mean the sum of observed frequency along the diagonal over the total minus the sum of the expected, which you have calculated, over the total. Then everything over one minus the sum of the expected over the total. So when you do that, you feed in, very simple. It gives you the answer. You get 0.737. If you run with SPSS, the same thing, when you run with SPSS, it takes you to go to cross tab and you click on kappa, it gives you, look at the answer, 0.737. So the value of 0.73 and above is said to be reliable. No, some people came with, some people say that anything 0.7 and above is reliable. No, many people came with a suggestion. Look at the interpretation here. We have two possible, two people, Sachet and Hartman. They even published their work the same year, 1991. Look at 0 to 0.1 slide. This one. 0.2 to 0.4 fair, that's for sachet, socket. Then 0.4 to 0.6 moderate, substantial, and almost perfect. Yeah, some people say that it is not possible for you to have reliability one, a system that is completely one. But no, it's the same rating. This one just call it poor, fair, moderate, good, very poor, very good rather. So that is how to, so when you are dealing with something that somebody rated, it's a little bit subjective. That is how to calculate the reliability. The dentist, that's their language. They do it a lot. Not only them, but I just observed over the years that most people, dental people, when they come with their research, they do that kappa because of the nature of their data collection. Now, let's look at internal consistency. If you have your question, you can send your question out. You type in it. Very soon we'll stop so that we can entertain question. This one is quite different from the first three. The first three is looking out and how the question go out. I mean, the two go out. Why the parallel form and test retest? Look at, okay. When you administer the questionnaire, how consistent is the response? Yes, because it's the response. But The same thing with the other one, the interrater, and interrater, the agreement of, is looking at the judgment of the rater, the people capturing the data. So how does their judgment, how consistent is the result coming from the judgment they give? Why this one just look at the two, since the two is made up of many parts, how consistent? Are they pointing to the same thing? That is internal consistency. You will see in the slide I showed before, you will see that even under that, you see half, split half, example of internal consistency, elaborate method, split half, Kuda, Richardson, Kronbach, we even have Gottman, we have many different forms. But you see that the most popular now is the Kronbach alpha. And the reason is very simple, because over the years, when those people came with, different people came with different way to actually know the internal consistency, of course, no other people will be building on what they have done until you get one that is best. And Kronbach alpha appear to be the best. Let's split up now. What please? Split half does is to divide the instrument into half. Well, if the instrument is the number of, the component, the items in the instrument, if it's 20 questions inside, split into 10, and now correlate. You know, we already said that if actually there's internal consistency, somebody that score high in one should score high in the rest. Anybody that score poor in one should score poor in low in the rest. So one way, someone just, they just thought of it. Okay, why not just, if that's the case, at random, you can just divide the questionnaire into two. So had all the questions and respond for one half and had all the response for one and correlate. No, instead of you administer the question two times and see, okay, because if that one is looking at the test results, but this one, if you want to look at the internal consistency, okay, why not split the question into two half? But sometimes if the question is even number, you cannot say that. You are just if there are 17, you have to split it to 8 and 9. So there's no way to be the same. But the issue there is that you now correlate. If actually there's internal consistency, you expect the correlation to be high in the sense that if somebody has scored low in one half, you score low in the other half. If all of them are pointing to the same thing, that's the logic. But the problem with that is that there are different ways you can split something to two. If you have question 1 to 20, you can say 1 to 10, 1 half, 11 to 21. You can say, okay, even number question should be on one side, odd number question should be on, or it can be half a side. So there are different ways. So it's not depends on the number of ways you can split now. It not depends on the number of questions. The permutation now depends on the permutation. So, and if you split in different ways, you may likely get different results. So that is why Kronbach now came. Okay, we now pick one and correlate the score of one with the rest and pick the other one. So for all of them, pick 1, 1, 1 for all the item and correlate with it and calculate the average. And that is what Kronbach did. And it comes out with this formula, very simple. Kronbach alpha, N, C all over this. So N here is number of items. If there are 4 items, N will be 4. There are 20 items, that make up the 2, N will be 20. Then C is average inter-item covariance among the items. For people that will be following us, you will not find it difficult to understand what covariance means. That is, you know, each of the question has its own variance. What we mean is that the score of each question, you can calculate the average score and the deviation. I mean the variance. You know, variance is square root of standard deviation. And standard deviation is square root of variance. But that for each of them. There are different ways you can pair them. Also, if you pair them, you can calculate their covariance. I think we have discussed about covariance before. So this one and this formula contain both the variance and covariance. See here is average inter-item covariance among the items. That is, if like, there are four items now, there are six ways you can pair four items. So that should allow you to calculate six covariance. When you calculate six covariance, you now average of the covariance. Then, because there are four, there will be four variances. Average of the variances also. That's what we have in the formula. Very simple. We have an example here. The four item. Why I choose this one? Because I have an example also that have 20 items. This one is four items. But this one is when you try to teach, you go with, try to choose the number that is manageable so that you can understand, conceptualize. If I choose 20 items, you don't know how many ways you can pair 20 things. It will be over no more than 200 ways. So we have to calculate 200 covariance with hand. Though for the computer, it will run it in a matter of seconds because there's a program. But choosing four items make it easier for you to conceptualize. Look at it. There are a four-item questionnaire in which each of the items was scored on the scale of 1 to 5 was administered to 60 respondents, calculate the global alpha. So there are, this is something now, subject 1 to 30, 31 to, so there are four questions. These are their score. So if you calculate, can you see, even with this one, see what I have to bring up. So you calculate, you will see the deviations, how they deviate from it. I calculate the deviation for each of them, 1, 2, 3, 4, then the square deviation, then the cross products, that is where the covariance comes. There are six of them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Because there are six ways you can pair four things. You know, you have four questions now. So you can pair it with 1 and 2 compare, 1 and 3 compare, 1 and 4 compare, 2 and 3, 2 and 4, and 3 and 4. Six ways. So the cross product, when you now calculate everything, the average of everything, the cross product, then add them and calculate the and feed it, it gives you the Kullback alpha 0.839. If you run it with SMA, it gives exactly the same thing. So I think we stop here for So I will take it bit by bit. So that because most of the time when you overload people with information, you now ask for questions. You will not ask, you just say, okay, it's okay. You don't ask questions. Maybe next I will seek to unravel how we go about the validity. Now, I don't know if there's any question. There are two chats. Yes, good evening. Please, can you add me to your WhatsApp? Yes, you send your number. Send the number. Oh, the person says, find the people understanding my teaching. Is it true? I think it's the foundation because, as I said before, some of the things we'll be talking about, covariance, correlation, we have already talked about some other things. So we cannot be repeating ourselves. It's just like anything advanced, there are some building blocks, basic, you'll have taken. It's just like somebody that not passed through primary school and now went to secondary school. So, though we have few people that are genius, so that can, maybe there's some spirit driving them also. You may know you have not gone to school, they can just go and cope. That's one in million times. So the issue here now is that maybe there's some basic thing. That's why just chat your number. And with all the lecture we have given, they are on the video. We have it on the YouTube. Through our website, just subscribe, you get it for a token. And we have over 100 videos now, yeah, because they are lectures and workshops. They explain all the anything you are looking for, they explain them very simple, and you will not find difficult understanding those things. I think there are something you need to know before you know something. So if you have not understood some basic concept of statistics, there's no way you be able to grasp reliability and validity very well. Then, thank you. Another person, please, sir, can you explain the comeback alpha again? You mentioned you score one and correlate with the other. Okay. Okay, that's great. Okay, sir. Okay, prof, thank you. Okay. So I will answer that question now. Okay, let me just go back to that Cronbach alpha. There's nothing special about it. The issue here, okay, let me start with it. You have a questionnaire, a tool that has certain number of questions. Let's look at the one we just example we gave now. There are four questions that form a two. Maybe that question, when the people have the question and it's placed on a like a scale of 1 to 5. For each of the questions, you either maybe strongly agree, whichever way. The options are 5, and you score on scale 1 to 5. If you are to add the score of one person together for all the questions, the highest anybody can have will be 20. Because the person that was, if somebody scored 5, 5, 5 in all the four, it will be 20. The highest anybody can have will be 20. That doesn't mean that everybody will have 20. So some will score 3 somewhere, 1 somewhere, 5 somewhere. But if let's say somebody score 5, 5, 5, not the 4, it will be 20. But that's not even the issue now is that the question one, each of those questions, if somebody score 4 in one, if that those questions, they are pointing to the same thing, this person should score. That person should score around 4 or 5 in the other one, 3, 4. So if the person is on the high side in one, he should be on the high side in the other 4. If somebody score low, maybe it's 1, around that 1 in one, it should be, even if you go to score 2, it should be around that for other. If that particular thing is asking the same question, you're like if you are good at physics and your another friend is good at biology. So when you go for physics, all the question, you are likely to get the answer if you are good for most of the question. Then if the person that is weak at physics, the issue there is that all the question they have, it will score low also. So if, and the issue there is that this one, though that example is not even a good example because when we are talking of all this, most of these you mentioned, quality of life, perception, all those things, emotion, depression, what you mentioned, they are not actually knowledge question. Because somebody was asking me day for yesterday about knowledge. If the knowledge will not come because knowledge question is possible to be sincere with you. Even when you are good at a particular subject, you may know some aspect, you don't know some aspect, you may know some question, you don't know question. But this one is not actually testing knowledge, it's testing attitude or testing emotion, testing some constructs, things that, you know, maybe happiness. So it's not based on whether you know it or not, because it doesn't test people's knowledge of it, rather more like attitude. So if that particular question, the whole two is looking at happiness. If somebody is happy, then if I am Mark mean happiness, that person somehow will, in all the item in that questionnaire, will score high. If the person is happy, because the thing will be pointing towards that is happiness. If somebody is not happy, in all the question, score low. But if somebody score low in one, score high, that should that, that thing is, and the person is not happy, that should that thing is not, it's not, it's called very low in one, in some, it's called very high, in some, moderately. That is not mentioning happiness. So And if the person is happy also, and he's calling low, calling her in one, it doesn't have, you don't have to score the same thing, but if somebody is on the high, TB 4 or 5, so that person, if that particular is measuring the same thing, that particular person will score something like that in all the questions. And if the person is low in that thing, should be scoring around 1, 2, 3, you know, down side. That is what it just means. That's just the mental picture I want you to have. So that what we call internal consistency. Is this question, is it consistent? That is, if this question is pointing at that thing, the second question, it should be pointing at the same direction, the third question. If it's not like that, that should that the two is not consistent internally. That's what it mentioned. So I think the person should understand now. Now, the way to do it is very simple. What Cronbach did was to, you know, for each question now, you know, there are many people that answer now. You can calculate the mean, variance, and standard deviation. That is the average value for each question and how they are spread. Then you can also calculate covariance. And that one, we'll not delve into that because you don't understand the meaning of covariance. When we're discussing correlation, we talk about covariance. That is why that correlation lecture is very important for this validity and reliability, because most of the method used in the validity is correlation. Most of the thing you do is correlation. Even reliability is correlation also. Even though they are trying to carve out reliability coefficient, but those reliability coefficients, they are a form of correlation. So issue of covariance come now. It was under the correlation we discussed covariance, because correlation is standardized covariance. So variance means how widespread, how the value of a particular variable vary in the population. Covariance is when you are considering two variables together, how do they vary together? What this one is talking about, question one and question two, how does it vary? Because if they are related, as we have said, they should vary together. If there's internal consistency, their variation, they should vary together. So what we now, when you talk about covariance, is that you now pair. That was what we did in the, if you look at the formula, it has the C mean average covariance between the pair, those questions. So in this case, we have four questions now. You have to pair, how many ways can you pair four questions? Question 1, 2, 3, 4. Question one can pair with question two. That's one. So you can know the covariance between them. Question one also can we pair, not even can, pair with question three. That's covariance between them. Make it two now. Question one can pair with question four. That is three now. Then two and three. That's four, fourth pair. Two and four, that is fifth, three and four. So there are four ways, six ways, you can pair four things. So the C here talk about, when you calculate the covariance for each of them, how put of it, because if they are pointing at the same thing, they should vary together. You know, they are variance, should be together. So that's what it means. As one vary, if one become higher, the other one should be higher also. That's what it means. So the variance, their covariance, you want to see, look at their covariance. And the covariance for you to calculate, you have to pair them. So there are four pairs, six pairs for four items. It is five items now, question, that will be 10 pairs. Can you see? If it is six, that will be 15 pairs like that. Now, if there are three questions, that will be three pairs. Now, the average, the covariance now from their pair, the average of the covariance, like in this case, there are six. After calculating the six covariance, you divide, you had and divide by six, that is the average. Then the average of their variance, there are four questions, so they have, each of them has its own variance. There are four. Can you see now? Because there are four questions, there are four variances. Because you can have six pairs from the four questions, there are six covariances. Can you see? So if you look at it, what we did here, I use this table to generate is the variance and covariances. But how do I generate variance? You have to calculate the deviation. Deviation for each of them, 1, 2, 3, 4. Then square deviation. When you square the deviation, when you now add it together and find the square root, you are cutting the variances. You now calculate the average rather, not square. Because variance is when you, in standard deviation, you get by square, calculating the square root of variance. So the covariances are the cross product. How do you get it through cross product? So we have the variances down in now. There are 4 variances, 1, 2, 3, 4. 6 covariances, 1, 2, 3. So in the formula now, because it's the average, can you see? We now had all the 6 covariances and divide by 6, can you see? And had all the 4 variances and divide by 4, can you see? And divide by 4 and B. So average covariance, average variance. And in starting the formula, the number of items is 4. 4 times the average of the covariances over the variances, the average of the variance is 1.16 plus, you know, in the formula, n minus 1 times the average of the covariances. It gives you 0.839. If you run it exactly, the expenses give the same value. Come back alpha. So I think it's well explained. For that person that has a question, yes, there are some other questions coming in. Thank you. Please, what is your two? You get it through, let me just share. You access it through our website. So let me just chat it now. Everybody. Leverage that. So if this person has asked a question, if you don't have, you are not on our WhatsApp, just chat your number. So that, because I send it to the WhatsApp also, to the WhatsApp group, and I will send it again. That is it. Leveragestart.com. So, I think that. Okay. Yeah, let me read some other question. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, wow, get now. Okay, somebody here has gotten it. Okay, sir, is this actually possible in the test that a questionnaire, somebody asked a question, may fail to the test? Yes, now, does that mean that the question in the questionnaire have different interpretation at different times? What can we, the explanation for a question failing the test? It means that it's not, the what you get from it, it may be that there are many things that can cause it. The question may not be measured well, we cannot say memory measured because that one is validity. The question may be difficult to answer, to administer. If the thing is very difficult to administer, or maybe people don't understand, you don't get consistent result from it. So there are many things that can cause that. It may be that maybe the question also is too, if it's too much also, and by the time you administer it, people lose interest. So you won't get consistent results. So there are many things that can make the instrument to be, you know, like when the instrument is not good, it may be, even if it's physical instrument, it's not doing, it may be that the material they use to make the instrument is not good enough. So that's just it. The property does not go in line with what you are doing. And like for RDT now, it may be sometimes the storage capacity. So there are a lot of conditions that affect it. So you have to go and check the instrument why it is not consistent. So then, okay, that's fine. Any other question? I've read through, and you can ask your question. You can unmute yourself and ask question. Unmute and ask question. So the person that is saying was find difficult to understand. The person has not shattered the WhatsApp, because I'm sure that person is not on the name, is not on our WhatsApp platform. The person should shut the number to me. If you don't want to publicize your number, just shut it privately to me. Please. Any other one? Okay, if there's no, let me just off, stop recording so that we can discuss other issues.